Get going. So we'll just start here. I'd like to introduce myself. My name's Tom Edwards. I work for Cray. I've worked for the Centre of Excellence, both for HECToR and now for Archer, for about the last 5 years. We sit sort of in collaboration with the sort of CSE support, and we're based here in Edinburgh, along in the offices of EPCC. There's my colleague Jason Beach-Brandt, who's also on the chat, or is also in the session, and we've been asked to sort of present a little sort of summary of some of the advanced features of the Cray XC30. So this is very much an optimization talk based on rank reordering. Any of you who've attended any of our performance workshops might recognize some of the slides, because I've borrowed quite heavily from that, but hopefully you should find it interesting. So if I start at the very beginning, the first order model of a parallel computer that I was taught, and a lot of people are taught, as is that basically you have this entity which has lots of parallel processing elements, be these CPUs or generally just nodes, some network which you communicate, data comes in, comes out, and you launch your MPI processes, and there's usually one of these per node. And this is a very simple model of a parallel computer, and it is sufficient to write all of the parallel applications that we see running on Archer. And this is how MPI is defined, how ShimMem is defined, how Fortran coarrays are defined. But one of the main things about this is that is the belief that the network and the nodes are homogeneous. So there is no difference between any particular rank and any particular point in the network. However, the reality is that we have a very non-homogeneous, well, not very, but a non-homogeneous system. So anyone who's been aware of any of the technology trends over the last decade will be aware that we've got many cores sitting in all of the nodes, and we often bundle these together, Cray certainly do, into multiple sockets, so we have many core fat nodes. And the nice features of these fat nodes is that we have shared memory across all of these cores, which means any core can access the memory of any other core, and thus any other process. And that means that we can do things like application shared memory threads, so standard OpenMP or POSIX, but in the majority of cases, we're actually probably doing things like launching multiple PEs, processing elements, so that's an MPI rank, a Fortran coarray image, or a ShimMem processing element, something like that. And we're launching multiple ones of those on each of the nodes. And communication libraries have now got sufficiently intelligent that they can actually exploit the shared memory element of this, and they can avoid sending messages over the network to PEs that are on the same node. So what this means is we now have two tiers of communication performance. We have the performance between nodes, inter-node, and the performance on-node. So if we look potentially, this is a slightly more complicated model. This might be a slightly more higher order model of a parallel computer. So we can see that we have the blue nodes with red MPI ranks or PEs, and there's different ways they communicate, but we've got multiple hierarchies here, and basically with non-homogeneous performance. So we can see in the XC30 case, a particular XC30 blade, we have the four nodes attached to the Aries, and these have their own memories. So there's two sockets. So we have a socket zero here, socket one for one node. They each have their own memory, and then they're connected to an Aries, and then these are connected to the wider network. And then we build these up into much bigger systems until we get to something the size of Archer. So we're connecting these together. So the hardware and the software and programming models all ensure that any sort of valid parallel application will work no matter how the ranks are placed on the node. The first order model still applies. You don't have to be aware of the these underlying differences to make a valid program. However, because we're generally interested in performance in the high performance domain, we can use these variations in performance to exploit the application runtime. So we can generally improve application runtime by being aware of how to exploit these minor differences in performance. And so we can typically do this in one of two ways. We can optimize the communication partners, so we can make sure that how our application communicates takes advantage of the better performance of the intranode communication. Or we can attempt to statically correct any load imbalance, or both actually at the same time, by redistributing the ranks in such a way that the amount of load per node is balanced over the cores. I'll explain a little bit more about that. So if we go and look at load imbalance, is probably one of the major issues that prevents scalability or application scaling to the highest sort of core counts. If you do a profiling analysis with something like CrayPAT and look at it through Apprentice 2, through the right combination of clicks, you can get a screen like this, and it will show you how the time spent in each routine varies across all of the PEs or ranks in your application. So you've got the maximum, the minimum, and the average values. And ideally, a perfectly parallel application will have this totally evenly distributed, and the difference between the maximum and the minimum will be zero, and it'll be the same as the average. In reality, this is different. Oh, so is the audio very choppy? I'll let it catch up a little bit. Hello? Okay, we'll just let it. Sometimes when listening to these things, it speeds up and slows down. Is anyone else having this problem? Or is it okay? Okay, I'll just carry on. Okay. So we can measure this imbalance by using CrayPAT. So if we can do a profile using the text report, we can see that we get average times for various parts of our application, but we also get this imbalance time and this imbalance percentage. So the imbalance time is the amount of time that usually is the difference between the maximum rank and, or the maximum amount of time spent, and the average. So this is the time we could potentially save by distributing the load more evenly. Percentage, we can also see here in the synchronization time with the MPI calls, we're getting time spent waiting for all of the parts of your application to enter this collective call. And again, this is all spent, this is all time which in theory, if we had a perfectly balanced application, a perfectly distributed application, we would be able to avoid. So how do we calculate this percentage time? Well, the percentage is the percentage of resources available that are being wasted. So it's a percentage of the time the rest of the team is not engaged in useful work for that function. So a perfectly balanced code would have 0% imbalance, but a serial code segment would have 100%. So it's kind of a measure of how well your application is parallelized. So ideally, what you want to be seeing is when you do a report like this, is everything has 0% imbalance time or 0 imbalance time as a raw measure. Also, you'll see things that said MPI sync time. You can measure the amount of time that the people have spent or ranks spend waiting to enter a collective. And again, you get that out by default with PAT report when you've got that when you've got that enabled. So you can tell where your application is getting, or you can tell that if there is imbalance by looking at your CrayPAT profiles. You also might just see it in your plain scaling that you're not getting to the scaling performance that you might expect from your application. So what are the causes of it? It could be there's many reasons for load imbalance. It could be that your decomposition isn't appropriate. You're not distributing work evenly across all of the nodes. And this is an area where our rank reordering, which I'll explain in a minute, could help. Or it could be that it could be coming from the computer communication. Is it the fact that you're doing all-to-one operations, or is there some reason you're concentrating communications on a particular thing, on a particular rank? So what we can attempt to do is we can attempt to do a thing called static load balancing. So if we imagine we had a set area or a set amount of a resource that was required for various threads, and this was not the same for each of these threads. So each of these blocks is an MPI rank, and the area of this bar is basically the amount of work that needs to be done. If we could strictly separate out the resource availability and we divide it into quarters between each of these ranks, then we'll be totally dominated by the particular rank which takes the most time. However, if we allow the resources to be shared dynamically, we can spread this area to sort of fill the gaps. And this is similar to how things like memory bandwidth behave. So if you have three or four cores operating simultaneously, can saturate the memory bandwidth of the node reasonably well. So if you place ranks which have the longest running time or the most demand for memory bandwidth along with ranks which have the least demand for memory bandwidth, that should average out to a better performance than having all of them on one rank. So if we imagine having things on different nodes is like separating them out strictly, but having them on the same node is like sharing the resources. So we can optimize our placement so that we get this sort of behavior rather than this sort of merged or smushed behavior rather than this separated out behavior. So rank placement, this is actually what we came here to talk about. How do we change how things are placed on the node? Well, by default, ranks are placed on the node in order that they are assigned. So MPI com world starts from zero up to the size of your domain, and rank zero is placed on the first node, rank one placed on the next core of the next node, and it just fills up in order. However, Cray the Cray MPI provides two other different approaches around robin placement, which places things on different nodes, and a folded rank placement. Probably the best way of this is all controlled via the mpitch rank reorder method environment variable. So you just set this inside your run script before the ap run command, and it will change how ranks are assigned to the nodes. So if we look at the various placements, in a round robin placement, what we do is rank zero gets placed on the first node, rank one gets placed on the next node, and so on and so on until we get to the end of the nodes. Then the next one is placed at the second position on the first node, and we start back at the beginning. And we fill in this round robin way, and we'll end up with an ordering similar to this. This is not the default placement, but this is what would happen if you said mpish rank reorder equals zero, just as a single command. The default placement is what we call SMP style, symmetric multiprocessor. We start with rank zero goes on the first node, rank one follows it on the first node, and we just fill up from the bottom, adding them in order until we filled up all of our spots. And this is the behavior that we'd normally expect. Folded placement, very, very similar to the round robin placement. We fill up, adding one processor onto each node until we get to the other end. Instead of starting back at node zero, we start at the end processor and we fill up backwards. So you get this sort of zipping or folded placement. And these are just different techniques for how to fill up the nodes with the ranks. They're somewhat arbitrary, and none of them is actually probably ideal for an application. It's probably better to follow to look at things on an individual basis, but you never know. Sometimes it's very difficult a priori to decide what would be the best placement, and because it's so easy to just change this with a single environment variable, all you need to do is do two additional runs beyond your default run just to see if this improves. And when this can be very useful when your point-to-point communication time is consuming a significant fraction of your program and it's detecting a lot of load imbalance. It's also been shown to help for collectives on your for collectives like all-to-all when you're not doing them across the entire application, so you're doing them on sub-communicators. It can also be useful to attempt to spread I/O out across the nodes. So if you have all of a few nodes or few ranks doing I/O, if these all end up on the same node, then that might not give you the best performance. You can use this technique to just change up or spread them out a little bit. The third example is, and probably the most powerful, is the custom rank reordering. So what you can do is you create a file called mpitch rank order, and it just contains a list of ranks and the and how they will be placed on the node. So the first number in the list gets placed on node 0, the second number gets placed on the second position in that node 0. And when mpitch rank reorder equals 3 is set at runtime, it will look to read this mpitch rank order file inside the current working directory, and it will assign the ranks accordingly. So in this particular example, we see the first rank 0 is being assigned to node 0, rank 1 being assigned to row 1, then 4, then 5, so following the list here. Then the next one should be 2, 2, 3, and then we can, where we've got consecutive runs, we can just put the dash notation to fill it up. So we can assign our ranks to the nodes in any order we choose. There is, and because the programming model ensures that there's no real difference between the ranks of to the ranks, it makes no actual difference to the program. It can't tell this It's just purely on a performance for a performance factor. Should it improve in general. So how do we generate these rank reorder files? It'd be very tedious to have to do it yourself, to do it by hand. It would be very brittle. It would only apply to a single decomposition. So CrayPAT should actually be able to give you rank reorder suggestions by default. So if you do a PAT build with APA or with GMPI linked in, so it can measure, it should be able to give you a metric based rank reorder. So this you'll find in the suggestion section of the report. And what will happen is it will attempt to order the ranks. So there are multiple ones, but in the metric based rank order file, it's attempting to even out the amount of user time spent by every single process by spreading them out across the nodes. So going back to this problem with having animations. We're trying to go from this static load balancing where we've got lots of variation in our runtime, and we're trying to choose the ranks that will best match or will best optimize themselves in this way so that they will even out overall. And there we go back. There we go. So rank reordering for this method, it's very, very easy. And the defaults at least should be tested with every single application. We've seen examples where things like the folded placement or the rank, the round robin placement from a theoretical level probably shouldn't give you any better performance, but for other reasons have improved application performance. Again, even if it gives you 2 or 3%, that's 2 or 3% more performance, which you've effectively got by just setting an environment variable. When would you might expect this to be useful? Well, it's usually when point-to-point communication is consuming a significant fraction of program time and the load imbalance is detected. And so these are similar arguments that I just made. The other reason we might use rank reordering is to optimize communications patterns. So going back to basics again, all non-embarrassingly parallel applications do some form of communication between the individual processes. And the cost of that communication is usually defined by two properties. So you have the latency, which is the minimum time it takes for a message to actually reach its destination, and you have the bandwidth, and that's the maximum rate at which data can flow over the network. And depending upon the size of the message depends upon whether the latency or the bandwidth will dominate. If we look at what the performance of an MPI message is, we can see here that for a single rank MPI, the inter-node message performance, we have a latency of around about 2 microseconds. And this is not the ultimate performance. This is me taking them with the Intel MPI benchmark. So very quickly, some of the network technicians will probably want me to. You can probably get better than this, but this is just me quickly doing it. And you can see that we're getting 2 microseconds, and this is between MPI ranks on different nodes. So this is going over the Cray Aries network. And we're getting up to sort of 6, well, almost 8 gigabytes per second bandwidth. However, if we look at the performance when we do a message between ranks on the same node, we can see that the latency significantly drops. We're going to under 0.5 microseconds. And the bandwidth also significantly increases. So we're getting up to 15 gigabytes per second. So we can see that there's a very big difference between messages transferred between nodes, between ranks on the same node and ranks on different nodes. And we can use this to really optimize our communication patterns. So many applications are only communicating with a small number of neighbors or a small number of other processors, other ranks. Then they're either doing global communications, which the MPI library should deal with. But it's very rare that you'll be doing large numbers of communications with lots of point-to-point communications like MPI send, MPI receive. Possibly if you've got some kind of strange solvers or unstructured mesh. But taking a typical example of a 2G boundary swap, you'll see behaviors like this. So we've got up-down, north-south, east-west neighbors, and they're just doing a boundary swap. With the default SMP layout, if we had 8 ranks per node, we'd see that we get these long, thin pencils. And we see that the communications crosses these dotted lines here, and here. And in total, we've got, if this was a much larger job and I could display it, we'd see that there are about 18 inter-node communication pairs per processor. That's 18 messages or message sets which have to travel over the network. And there's a finite amount of bandwidth, which we just measured, so it'll take 1/18th of the time to sort of get across the network. However, if we reordered ranks so that we used a sort of more square decomposition, so that we had 4 by 2 cells sitting on the same node, then we actually can reduce that down to 12 inter-node communications using this rank reordering. And that actually will mean that we could get, what's that, 18, almost 50% more bandwidth or 50% faster communications because we're only sending two-thirds of the data over the network that we were before. We're still going to be dominated in latency probably by the communication pattern because we're still doing inter-node, but bandwidth-wise, we're really making more effective use. And this is really even more important as we get to fatter nodes. So with 24 or 48 ranks per node, we can make things even better. We can get even better results. So if we do a little table with Ivy Bridge, if we have a 2D cell size of 24 by 1, in a 2D decomposition, we have 50 off-node messages. But if we can rearrange that to 6 by 4, we can reduce that to 20. And similarly, with the 3D cell sizes, we can go from 24, but the default layout would give us something like 24 by 1 by 1, which is 100 off-node messages, whereas we can reduce that down to almost 52. So anything where you're approaching squares and cubes are best. So what CrayPAT can do is it will attempt to detect a grid inside your application. It will attempt to analyze the communication pattern and try and find any grid patterns that it can. And it's pretty good at doing this. So this is a particular example from LAMPS, which does print out its grid, and it was 8 by 12 by 16. And it will generate here this mpitch-rank-order.grid file, so that you should find sitting in your run directory after you've done PAT report, and you can use that file with the run. You have to rename it mpitch rank order, but it gives you an estimate of how much of the on node, how much of the percentage of communication will be on node versus off node. So with SMP and round robin and folded, or with this custom rank reordering file that it suggested. So it's suggesting here that it can get 64% or 65% of the communication on node using this method. So it's doing that automatically for you just by running through CrayPAT. If you don't want to use CrayPAT, we also have this grid order tool. And what this will do is it can generate MPitch rank reorder files just by giving it some external arguments. So you give it the global grid size, you give it your cell grid size, and also whether it's row major or column major, and it will generate an MPitch rank order file for you, which you can use. So you could put this into your run scripts so that, you know, if you definitely already know how your code is going to decompose the problem, you don't want to run it through CrayPAT first, you can just use this grid order program instead. And again, it's a very useful technique for doing this. So we've talked about these two methods for addressing load imbalance and addressing communications. In some ways, they're actually contradictory. If you optimize for balancing your user time or your memory bandwidth, you may be countering it by moving communications that were once neighbors far away from each other. So you sort of counter this. So CrayPAT has a third option, this hybrid time, where it attempts to optimize both. So this is sort of a graph partitioning problem. And it will generate a rank order file which attempts to match as much as it can while also maintaining as much of the communication on node versus off node. And so this is the third option. So a lot of the time you should be able to see three MPitch rank order files coming out of your coming out of your PAT report when you're doing your analysis. That's the basics of how to do it. I've just now got a couple of examples of how this has been used in quite a powerful way to kind of address certain problems with certain applications. And then once I've covered that, we can either answer any questions or talk. I think there's some other people who've got some examples. In this particular application, we have a series of IO servers. IO servers are very useful. What they do is they act as sort of MPMD. So you have some compute nodes. So if you have a pattern of communication where you're doing compute, IO, compute, IO, compute, IO, rather than waiting for that IO to happen, you can overlap compute and IO by offloading your operations to some set of ranks you determine as IO servers. In this particular case, we had a weather code, a model which decomposes a latitude-longitude grid, and we found that the decomposition was best when the east-west, all of the east-west ranks were on the same node, because there are very deep halos and a lot of the communication then was happening inter-node. So if we just decompose this particular problem onto four nodes, we get these whole lines on the same node, and we get good performance. However, we introduce these I/O servers. We have to introduce extra ranks. By default, was to place a new one onto each node. And what happens? We see that we displace some of our nice long lines of east-west ranks off onto the next node. So we're now introducing an additional communication pattern between them. Give me a second. Sorry, bugging my throat. We're introducing an additional synchronization across the node, so we're destroying the performance here potentially unnecessarily, and basically it just cascades throughout. Even if we just add one rank, we're really just messing this entire nice ordering up. So the advantage of this is that it's easier to implement in this way. You can just choose a random rank or just choose the nth rank to be the I/O server. And it's efficient when the number of nodes is equal to the number of I/O servers. We can have one I/O server per node, and we're distributing the I/O traffic across the nodes. But we are destroying this nice alignment. And your I/O servers have got the same memory limits as any other compute rank. So they're competing for resources along with your compute nodes here. Instead, what we can do is we can just use rank reordering without altering the code at all to just pick up these nodes and pick up these ranks that are IO servers and just place them on the end node. This has disadvantages. What has advantages is that we're keeping the nice alignment between the processor decomposition and the nodes, and we can change the distribution of ranks across the nodes easily. So we can have a large number of ranks on the node where we're doing intense computation, but we can use fewer ranks per node where we need more memory, because I/O servers are basically a form of caching. And we can just do this entirely with an mpish rank reorder file. We don't have to touch the code at all. But it does have a disadvantage that we're concentrating a lot of I/O traffic onto a few nodes in the system. But we found that this actually didn't, that the network bandwidth is much, much greater than the I/O bandwidth, so that's okay. And the I/O servers are there to hide your I/O delays anyway, so it's only really at the last stage that this ever would really be a problem. So by default, most applications launch with just with an AP run command, and they provide a single set of AP run options, which means that every node and every rank has a homogeneous environment, so you have the same number of ranks per node. And that's great for these homogeneous SPMD applications, so where you're doing the same thing. However, AP run also allows you to launch applications in MPMD mode, and what this means is you can change the density of your ranks per node halfway through, or have a different set. And this means we can change where we've got an MPMD style application, even though it is the same binary. There is a different the IO server ranks are doing different things compared to the compute ranks, so they may have different memory requirements. So in this case, they need large memory buffers, so we need far fewer of these per rank per node, whereas the compute nodes we can pack much more densely. So we can use the MPMD mode and rank reordering to create this sort of mixed mode environment and allows this nice decomposition to continue. So in this particular example, what we've done is we've used AP run to create six MPMD sort of regions. So we have the first region here, then which we're going to use for compute, and we've used a second region here, and we've launched with only two ranks per node, in these high memory regions, and with 12 ranks per node in these dense regions. Now, this particular example came from HECToR, where it was advantageous to move your I/O servers away from each other so that you didn't have them bunched up together because of the number of links. With Aries, the density of connections that you have to every other node is so dense that, to be honest, you probably only need two regions here. So you could move all of these I/O nodes all to the end. But basically what we've managed to do is we have 72 compute nodes where we've got 12 ranks with two threads each, densely packed, and then we've assigned three I/O server nodes where we've just got two ranks per node with two threads, but lots and lots of memory. And with combination, we can, because we've done the MPMD mode, and we know the ordering of the ranks, we can use the mpitch rank reorder file to just place the I/O server ranks onto these nodes. And this is done without any modification to the code. The code is completely and blissfully unaware that it's running in this way, but we see, I think it was a 7 to 8% improvement in performance this way. We've talked a lot about ordering ranks on a node, but we also have these NUMA regions. So we have NUMA nodes within the socket, within the Cray node. So again, taking a weather example, we have the shortwave radiation is only active on one side of the globe. So if we have a similar decomposition, a longitude decomposition, only half of the ranks are going to be active at once. And we also know that we get nice best performance when we have long lines in the east-west direction on the same node. So that means that we're going to have half of the cores on any node probably active at once. So what we want to do is sort of mix this up. What we can do is we can end up with imbalance between the sockets. So if we look for the default SMP placement, we just place the first 16 ranks in order across the sockets. So the first 8 ranks in this particular example, because there are two threads, are assigned to the first socket and the next. So in this particular example, we see we've got 7 active ranks on one socket and only one active on the other socket. And this isn't allowing us to do that shared dynamic balancing of memory bandwidth. We have a lot more memory bandwidth happening on socket zero, activity happening on socket zero compared to socket one. So we're introducing a sort of load imbalance here. Whereas if we choose a different ordering, a rank reordering, where the same ranks are on the same node, they're just in a slightly different order, we can guarantee that no matter what sort of half or with, what combination of ranks are active, we will, always distribute 4 of them on each socket. So we can see as we move, it just changes. So the load moves from socket zero to socket one with the default placement, but with the changed, improved placement, we can distribute it more evenly across the two sockets. So in conclusion, most modern supercomputers, like the Cray XC30, have some form of hierarchy of performance. There is some non-homogeneity. There's going to be some better performance for things that are on the same node versus things that are at different nodes. And rank reordering allows us to tune applications for this underlying architecture without changing results or source code. This is very useful for someone like me, who works with a lot of different codes, and is a bit of a jack of all trades. I end up having to deal with codes which I haven't developed, haven't worked on, and trying to optimize these and doing it without having to actually go into the source code at the first orchestration is very, very useful. And again, these performance gains are usually for free. We're not talking about adding more nodes or spending more resources. It's really just changing some of the environment variables and getting these, hopefully, performance improvements without any particular gain. And especially as tools like CrayPAT can provide optimized orderings automatically for you, and usually after just a single pass, then we'd really recommend using them just to kind of, especially if you've got a big campaign or a long series of runs using a similar set of applications or a similar setup, it really would improve. If you can get just a few percent improvement, then that can give you a little bit more breathing room or a little bit more resource to do other things with. So thank you very much for listening. That sort of covers that. If anyone has any questions, I'm very happy to answer them. Or if anyone has any general questions about the Archer service or anything, we've got Andy Turner here, who is from the Archer Center CSE, Computational Science and Engineering Support Team. I think there's some other users who've seen some good uses. We've got Adrian Jackson here, who has seen some really good results for GS2 with rank reordering. Well, you've all gone to sleep. The question was, what happens if you do your own pitch rank order file wrong and you get the wrong number of orderings in? I think what happens is it just fills it up in SMP ordering with the remaining numbers. But I can't remember. That's obviously erroneous behavior. So the custom rank reordering is a little bit brittle because it only works for one number of ranks. So it's why it's quite useful to have grid order, or I've written a lot of Python scripts which do generate these files based on orderings. Do you want to take this? Do you want to take
it? Take over speaking from Tom for a second. I was just going to say I have played around with this tool for a plasma code called GS2, and for that code, for the particular run I was doing on 1024 cores, I could get it to go somewhere between 15% and 30% faster by using a rank reordering suggested by CrayPAT. Of course, it was limited to one number of cores, but interestingly, actually, the GS2 is very heavily dominated by MPI, but it wasn't the MPI reordering which helped here. It was a user reordering, so it was moving the the different processor rounds are bounced across the nodes. And I think that's because there's a lot of sub-communicator work going on in here. So at some points, this processor's not doing anything. And maybe on some nodes, they're quite concentrated and doing lots of, it seems to. But yeah, up to 30% faster just by plugging in this custom rank reorder. So it's quite nice in that aspect.
So the question from Louis TN1 is that it's not able to detect. So it can't detect the grid performance. So it can't just say this is an 8x12x16 problem in that particular case. What it can do is it will attempt to optimize sort of on a graph placement, I believe. So as long as your unstructured problem is constant and that decomposition doesn't change throughout the run, or that it won't change from run to run, so the partitioning algorithm is sort of deterministic, it should be able to provide you with some rank reordering files. What's quite useful, actually, is CrayPAT can give you a rank reorder file based on any metric or nearly any metric. So if you've got counters in there, so it can try and level or optimize based on the number of D1 cache misses. That's not a shared resource, so it's probably not going to give you a great result. Whereas user time is it's using that as a shorthand for memory accesses or memory bandwidth. But CrayPAT hopefully should be able to give you something for an unstructured one. It's more difficult and it's much harder to explain. But there should be similar ideas. If you place more cylindrical sort of parts of your decomposition or parts which are more likely to communicate with each other on the same node, then that definitely will help. Yes, as Andy just mentioned, it can also help balance. It just helps balance the load. A lot of the time, it's going to be a case of you turn it on, it either makes it run faster or slower, or doesn't make any difference. And the explanation is harder. It can be quite hard. I've shown examples where we can give clear explanations to why the performance improves. Sometimes, as in Adrian's case, we're not completely sure why it's improved, but it has. You could do a lot of investigation, but you just get it for free, especially if you're practical. Yeah. So, Louis, are you running your own application you're compiling yourself, or are you running one of the centrally installed applications? So there is some question, I think, here about whether it would be useful to have instrumented versions of the centrally installed applications so that you wouldn't have to do anything particularly with CrayPAT. You just run a slightly different binary and then you just get a CrayPAT trace out automatically. So if it's a custom app, then you just use the standard either CrayPAT or CrayPAT Lite. CrayPAT Lite, there's instructions on how to use CrayPAT with automatic profile analysis on both the Cray website and the Archer website. There's a good sort of step-by-step guide there. But there's also CrayPAT Lite, which is an even quicker way, and that should also be able to give you a single MPI rank reorder file in one step. So section 5 of the best practice guide will give you good instructions on how to use CrayPAT to just instrument your application. And one of the first things you get out should be these rank reorder files. So the question was earlier, does any of this apply for Cray's and Shimem? Though it says MPI rank reorder file, the rank reorder file will work for Shimem or Cray's, and it's a similar idea. I haven't looked to see if it does. It should give you an MPI rank reorder file based on user time, because that is independent of the model you use. It probably wouldn't do grid detection there, so it probably can't work out. But I haven't tried that. Question: can CrayPAT diff two runs? you can load two AP2 files into... No, I don't think so. It would be a nice feature, I agree. No one mentioned anything. But yes, I believe, so because we're based here in the PCC, there was my colleagues, Harvey Richardson and Alistair Hart, possibly investigated some tools for visualizing the output of CrayPAT in slightly different ways, part of their early work. So they might have a way of diffing it. But you can export it in CSV format, a lot of the data. You can just dump it into Excel. But no, there is no way of diffing it. It is a bit... It would be nice because you could put a start run or a short run and a long run and then just diff the two to remove your initialization time. I can put it in as a request for enhancement. So, the question is, does CrayPAT play nicely with installed modules? Yes, so all of the Cray-supplied modules, ones which have Cray-dash, should be instrumented to work with CrayPAT. So you should be able to see inside your PETSI library the individual PETSI calls. And similarly with BLAS, you should be able to see calls to DGEM, to whatever. I'm afraid I can't think of a PETSI call. I'm not a PETSI expert. But yes, it should work without any problems there with Cray PETSI. The system install modules, in the worst case, what would happen is that the time would be in a higher level routine. So if you called a library which wasn't CrayPAT aware, some TSL or something which wasn't supplied by Cray, what you'd see is the time would be attributed to the parent routine. So your user routine that called the library call, but you wouldn't see it as a separate sort of call. Yes, if you did a sampling experiment, you can see it line by line. If you do trace, you don't get line numbers. So if you did the sampling, the first step of the APA, it would all sort of appear in the line, which was roughly associated with where that call came from. So if we look at, you can see what targets you can meet. So if I share my session here, so if we share this, we can do a type. There. So what you might, if you were doing this manually, you might want to add to your trace group dash G, and then I think there's a PETSI option. So you can just add G PETSI to your build path or to your APA file. And that will allow the support to see which functions. And similarly, you've got all these other ones, netcdf, shmem. Common ones are obviously MPI is a big one. Okay, I don't have, it's not on here, so. So, here you can see it's, for this particular lamp's example, it's produced a grid which was 8 by 12 by 16, the corresponding report from CrayPAT. It's all under this section here, observations and suggestions. This table is a different table, the end of the table. This is showing the load imbalance on a per PE basis, so it's showing how the which PE is the greatest, which PE is the least, taking the least time, and the one I think it's the median, or the one that's closest to the mean. I think it's the median there. So for user time, this is showing that PE144 took 103 seconds of user time, whereas PE1030 only took 93. And the average or the median was there, whereas sync, and it just breaks up into sync time. These into the big sections. So user time is time spent by the application in a user function, a function programmed by the user or compiled by the user. MPI sync time is the time spent waiting to enter a sync. Because this is low for this particular one here, 936, it's actually PE953, which has the most load because it's got the least sync time. And you can also, it'll also tell you if that load imbalance is coming because you're getting different amounts of communication. So here we can see that there is a small variation in the amount of MPI traffic that's going between the ranks, between the maximum and the minimum, but it's not a huge amount. It's not really. And the average message size is roughly the same. So it's probably not that your communication load is coming from different sending messages of different sizes. It's probably more likely coming from it being a bit the actual application running at different speeds or some other feature. So yeah, that's the classic table. This is a very short run with lamps. This is hard. Yeah, I think this would be the read time. So I took lamps and I took a sodium chloride example, and to get it enough atoms, I just did it's a text ASCII file. It's a four gigabyte ASCII file that it reads in through standard in as a data file. No, I think it's just one rank. So I think that happens before the initialization. I think. This is me searching for an example that would work with the rank reordering. So I wanted to find something that would have a grid style decomposition, which wasn't weather code. So I picked this one. Yes, are there any more questions or anything at all? Art related. Okay, yeah, so if you do think of anything, then if you want to email the help desk, helpdesk@archer.ac.uk, and yeah, you can get in contact with me, tedwards@cray.com. Okay, well, thank you very much for attending, and I hope it was useful. It would be very interesting to hear of any examples, especially if you have some really good results. If you don't get some good results, then obviously SMP placement is good. But yes, I would be really interested to hear any feedback from the session. If not, thank you for listening and goodbye.